Good morning, everybody. Glad to have you again this morning. I hope everybody is enjoying the weather, even though it's a little overcast. But at least it's not stormy.
But it is cold where we are. Is it warmer down there?
For me, it's not too bad. Although I haven't gone outside, so I really can't say for sure.
Yeah, we opened our windows by mistake last night.
Oh, yeah. For a good portion of the day yesterday, I had my back door open. I got one of those screens that you kind of hang like a drape in the door and it has the magnets that close it.
Uh-huh.
Because I have no screen doors and all of my windows are, let's just say they're not very good windows. So that was the best way to get fresh air in the apartment. And it was a bit chilly last night.
It was chilly. Everett, good morning. How are you doing today?
Doing fine. Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's see, we've got Lowell coming in here in just a moment.
Neota, good morning.
Let's see, we've got Mary Jane. I see Carol, Kathy.
Lorena.
Esther. And Pat. So we've already greeted Neota. And we just had, where'd she go? Jeanette just dropped in on us. So we've got her with us now.
So I'm going to let you all know, yesterday I had this really intense conversation with a bunch of ministers. And the question was one that you all can probably answer. Is the church hug now no longer valid? Or is the church hug going to be revived after COVID?
I'm reviving it.
I've already revived a couple times when I knew somebody was vaccinated and I'm vaccinated. So yes, I think it'll definitely come back in most of the churches that I know of.
Okay.
I know Lillian is definitely going to be bringing that back if she knows that you're safe and able to be hugged, because she's an awesome hugger.
Yoda, what do you think?
Okay, I think that I am so filled with joy when I see people that I spontaneously hug people. Quite honestly, I even got in trouble during the pandemic. I saw someone and, you know, on the street, and I was just so happy to see them that it's just a spontaneous happiness to see people.
In worst case scenario, there's still always the elbow bump.
Elbow bump doesn't quite do it.
It doesn't. You definitely need more of that wraparound.
We're going to reach a point where we do gyrations when we meet someone trying to figure out
our own secret handshakes.
So you know what's going to really be interesting? So this was a conversation from pastors who were all appointed last year and have never seen their congregation in person.
And oh, wow.
So all of us were saying that on our last Sunday this year, this is going to be the first time we can hug everybody. And that's really been a challenge, because most of us like to hug anyway. And I really do believe that Christians hugging each other is a part of our own spiritual and physical health. Mm-hmm. So let's keep each other in prayer. But I think it's really interesting to have that conversation.
Definitely. Welcome, Lillian. Lillian just joined us.
Lillian, I see Lowell has joined us. Kathy, good morning, Kathy.
Good morning.
Carol has joined us.
Howdy. And Jeanette accidentally got bumped off, so she's back in now. There she is. All right. So I hope that everyone is ready for enjoying the day tomorrow. I hope everyone has the day off for those that are working, with it being the Memorial Day Monday. And I hope that all of you who have served in the military, we want to extend our thank you to you for your service. But also want to, especially today, keep in mind all of those who served but were never able to make it home. for providing us the ultimate of sacrifices to protect our rights, to be able to do the very thing that we're doing today. We don't know what the world would have been without their sacrifice. So for them, we are truly and eternally grateful. Let's see, we've got...
Could I mention a memory? Our church is located on Route 50. And on the Memorial Day weekend, I think this is the first weekend without Rolling Thunder, which memorializes those who were missing in action. They are still being remembered. And from our sanctuary, we would hear the motorcycles rolling by as they remembered the POWs and missing in action. And just to put your statement.
And the church behind us would allow a lot of the participants to camp on the property. So that was a wonderful thing to see them all. By the time we were rolling into church, they were up and finishing breakfast and getting ready to roll. So it was a beautiful thing to see.
One Sunday morning, a couple of them came over from where they were parked and had fellowship with us.
Mm-hmm. Wow. That was awesome too.
So for the record, if you have not seen the church in the last day or two, there are flags all out in front. Pastor Hugh and his congregation yesterday went out, was it yesterday or Friday? I'm sorry, went out and put out flags for Memorial Day. So I should have taken a picture. But it was cold yesterday. I was walking fast.
On the first Vietnamese Facebook page, there are pictures posted.
Good, good, good. Well, it looks like everybody is here. First, I want to say thank you for coming to worship this morning. And I really do wish we could all be in a group hug together. But in light that we cannot, we're going to still welcome God's presence among us so that God can be glorified and that as each one of us fellowships, we are reconnected with what God has put deep inside of us, the Holy Spirit, to bring us into a relationship like none other. So let us open worship today saying, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice
and be glad in it.
And if you haven't noticed, every Sunday that brings a joy to my face. Because every day is a great day for God to do something in our lives. Today, we're going to have a hymn sing, and it's going to be a little bit different than normal. We're going to do one verse of a lot of hymns that you all requested. And then there are about four hymns that were requested that we're going to use in our last three worship services. But the words will be on the screen. We're going to invite you to mute yourself and sing. But we're going to invite you to sing along with the hymns. And then the message today will come from Romans 8, 27 and 28. And so worship along with us. We have three announcements for the church. The first one is that anyone who would like a transfer, a formal transfer to another congregation other than Clarendon, I'm asking that you please send your request in writing. Emily will fill out the information and then she will give it to me to sign. I will send a copy to the pastor, give you a copy so that it's official. But I'm asking that you do that by June 20th. The second thing is that Emily will be out of the office this week. She has vacation. We're celebrating her being with her family and being on vacation. But as a result, I'll be in and out the office. I'll answer the phones when I'm there. But if you specifically need me for something, please use my cell phone and I'll get back to you as quickly as possible. Leslie, I think there were two other announcements.
Yes, we have the church council meeting on June 2nd, I believe it is, at 7:30 p.m. And that will be on Zoom. I will have the links actually go out this afternoon so that everyone will have that reminder each day up until the about an hour before the meeting. And then let's see. Oh, the dinner on the 14th.
the dinner on the 14th, we're asking that you register with Emily. This is for everybody who's a member of the church. We'll be going to Outback. We'll be meeting at 5:30. They have reserved the whole back of the restaurant for us. Those who are not vaccinated will have to sit on one side, but all those who are vaccinated, the whole middle part of the restaurant will be available to us. And this is our fellowship together. I believe one of the past pastors will be coming to join us. But the goal of the dinner is for us to tell stories about the memory and legacy of Arlington Forest. So I understand that there was a party, a picture watching party yesterday or the day before with Neota and Lorena and Mary Jane. that's the types of stories we want to tell about the history. Like Lorena just brought up a little bit earlier about some of the people from the Rolling Thunder coming to visit. What other stories in the life of the church need to be told so that we can continue to tell those stories? That's what we would like to do. Are there any other announcements?
None that I'm aware of. I don't see any hands raised.
So let us prepare our hearts for worship. Let us pray. Magnificent God, in the midst of this day, let our hearts be reflective of all that you've blessed us with, especially the freedoms that you've provided for us. But let our hearts be humbled at this time as we receive your spirit in this worship service through song and spoken word. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Please join us in our call to worship. Though like the wanderer, the sun gone down, darkness be over me, my rest a stone. Let all my song shall be nearer, my God, to thee. Nearer, my God, to thee. Nearer to thee. Well, sorry, I apologize. I don't know where that slide went. There it is.
In the water is a flower, in the sea and
And now we will have our opening hymn, It Is Well With My Soul.
Thank you.
Apparently I'm getting touch happy with my mouse button. Today's scripture reading will be from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 27 and 28. And we are using the English Standard Version. And he who searches hearts knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. This is the word of God for the people of God. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Once again, let us pray. God, thank you for this moment in your scriptures. Eliminate William Cheney so that your voice may be heard to these, your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to first thank Linda and her husband, Jefferson. They have participated in worship with us many times in the past. And I want to say thank you to them once again for their offering. The sermon title today is It Will Be Well. Not everything's okay right now. It will be well. And it centers around this thought that when the hymns were written, they were all written for a specific time and a specific group of people. According to Dr. Sean Hahn, professor of sacred music at Perkins School of Theology, which is one of our 13 United Methodist seminaries, this song was written by Horatio Spafford. He was a Presbyterian. He was a musician within the Presbyterian Church. He lived in Chicago. He established a very successful legal practice as a young man, but during the crash in the Great Chicago Fire in 1871, he lost everything. He lost everything to the point where the devastation, the very house he was living in, the houses that in the homes he had invested in on Lake Michigan were all lost during that time. The hymnologist Kenneth Olsbrecht says that desiring a time of rest, right after this happened, he wanted his wife to rest and sent his four daughters off to England. And during this trip, the boat was hit and it sank within 12 minutes. When his wife was finally able to wire him, her message was this: I was alone saved alone. Meaning all four of his daughters were killed in that wreck. He immediately left to be with his wife. And as he was on his way, the boat that he was on passed the area in which supposedly their ship had sank. And that's when he penned the words, "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul." This hymnody that we are endeavoring to be embraced in our lives is more than just songs that we sing on a Sunday morning. They're more than just songs that are part of our rituals of worship. These hymns are part of our lived reality, because the men and women who wrote these hymns had a life experience that emanated and actually produced many of these hymns. Whether they're the Charles Wesley hymns or the Charles Tinley hymns or the hymns written by Carlton Young, some more contemporary ones. All of these hymns were rooted in someone's experience. And this is part of what this particular hymn kind of brings up, that there was an overwhelming emotional experience and he focuses energy on writing rather than being in despair. You see, these feelings that I can imagine that he was feeling, the sense of tragedy, heartbreak, misfortune, the anguish, the sorrow, the despair that Horatio must have been feeling in order to write such deep words in "It Is Well With My Soul." They're all human emotions. And the reality, this the reason why this song has endured over time, that through many generations as well as cross cultures, is because we all experience these human emotions. None of these emotions are foreign from any of us. And the reality is, when we understand how powerful these emotions are, we understand that it has an effect on us. When I first read the story, I began to ask a question that Robert Schuller asked many years ago. Why do bad things happen to good people? I ask it a little bit differently. I ask the question, why do bad things happen to God's people? What goes on that in the midst of us living our lives for Christ, in the midst of us trying to be the best men and women that we can be on behalf of God's kingdom, things happen in our life that totally devastate us, crush us, take us out of the loop of being functional in society. Sometimes it's our family, sometimes it's our finances, sometimes it's even stuff we personally go through. This pandemic has shown us the ups and downs that an individual can go through, from one minute being elated to be alive and being depressed because we're isolated. You know, why do bad things happen to good people? This question must have been ringing out in California today, as some people went to work on Wednesday in Santa Clara at the Transit Authority, and a lone gunman in a mass shooting killed so many, including himself. Why do bad things happen to good people? The 6-year-old Aiden Leos, an innocent boy in the back seat, shot because of someone's anger and road rage. Why do bad things happen to good people? Why did 594,000 plus people die from the coronavirus, leaving people, homes, families, communities, and nations devastated? Well, here's a reality. I cannot answer all of those questions. I don't have a definitive answer. But I start at this scripture because this is such a complex question. I start at Romans 8, 27 and 28, which simply says again, "The one who searches hearts knows how the Spirit thinks, because he pleads for the saints consistent with God's will. We know that God works all things together for good for those who love God and for those who are called according to his purpose." That becomes a scripture of safety in the midst of calamity. That becomes a scripture that is a soft place to land in the midst of hard times. This scripture begins to unfold and to embrace us, even though it may not totally comfort us in the times of tragedy. So I'm just going to share with you three things that I have learned over this last year about tragedy and calamity, and ways that we can deal with it based on listening to Horatio's story, the scripture, and like I said, some of my own experience. First, if we want to really move beyond the tragedy, we have to develop rituals of remembering. Rituals of remembering can be passed down from generation to generation and introduced to others who may have almost forgotten that event. I'm impressed by the many memorials that are developed at the places of tragedy, whether car accidents or where someone may have lost their life. But I'm more impressed with the people who keep the memory alive year after year after year. The initial devastating impact can many times be experienced through media or social media, but the subsequent years takes a lot of planning and work. Some people get frustrated when they keep hearing Those in the Black Lives Matter say their name, which is a way of remembering the lives of those who've been lost in different types of ways through this season of violence against Black men and women. We must understand that rituals of remembering are essential to societies as well as to individuals. This weekend, the United States is actually in the midst of one of those rituals of remembering. Memorial Day is a day that we have set aside on the last Monday of every May to remember and commemorate the men and women who have served in our military service, who have given the ultimate sacrifice. They have died in service to our country so that we can live with the freedoms that we have. This remembrance allows the entire country to never forget that our freedoms are not truly just free. They're earned. And there are men and women out there who are willing to fight for them on our behalf. The second ritual of remembrance that we're in this week is the Tulsa Race Massacre. On this very day, and actually May 31st and June 1st, we've remembered the fact that there were white mobs in Tulsa who were deputized by city officials and attacked Black residences and businesses in the Greenwood District in Tulsa. The massacre occurred when Dick Rowan, a young Black shoe shiner, was accused of assaulting Sarah Page, a white elevator operator. The reports all say that Roland tripped into Page's elevator, but when a white store clerk saw it, he reported the incident as an assault or rape. Between 100 and 300 Black people were killed, and more than 6,000 were displaced from their homes on that weekend. This has a special significance for me because I have been a part of the United Methodist response this year at remembering the 100 year anniversary of that massacre. You see, the United Methodist Church acknowledges that we didn't do enough at that time, and that what we want to do is never forget. So as a part, we've put churches strategically in that area to serve through a school, through a clinic that is run by the United Methodist Church, and English as a second language at several of our churches for the people who are currently living in that Greenwood area. Rituals of remembrance help us to remember the tragedy, not so we can be sad, but so that we can celebrate the lives of those who were a part of the tragedy. The second thing that I've learned is something I learned from Horatio. When bad things happen, we need to focus our energy on our legacy, not the event. What do you mean by that? What we see is that at the point when he was grieving the most, after losing four children, after losing all of his wealth, all of that, he wrote the song, "It Is Well With My Soul." He focused his energy on how do I share with people that even in the midst of calamity, my faith is ruling. And even in the midst of such tragedy and sadness, God still rules in my life, and God still is in control of my life. We are asking that question all the time when bad things happen. But what Horatio did is he wrote the song, "It Is Well With My Soul." What is it that you will write? Or what is it that you will say? What is it you will videotape? How do you focus your energy so that the event doesn't die with that moment, but it lives forever? That was the second thing I learned. And the third thing was, this is personal. This is the one thing I learned through tragedy, is that when bad things happen, we need to renew our faith. We need to get more committed to our spiritual disciplines, when really we could become angry with God. We could get despondent. We could turn away from God. But when we renew our faith, we get totally focused on our spiritual disciplines. We then see the reality of the scripture living in our lives. For all things work together for good for those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. When we deepen our relationship, our love for God, God is present in the midst of our circumstance, the challenge, the frustration, the loss of life, the loss of friendships. God is there, but that's because we fall deeper in love with God, even in our tragedy. That is such it doesn't make sense to the normal mind, but it is how God provides comfort to us in the midst of time of challenge. You all have been with me for last year, and you understand how I just love Christmas. But what you may not know is that I often, really a lot, I sing Christmas hymns every time I feel like I'm getting depressed or challenged as a way of renewing my faith. You see, the Advent season prepares us for Christmas by reminding us of the hope, the joy, the peace, and the love that can be found in the birth of Jesus Christ. After a significant tragedy, and even today, many of these hymns renew our faith in God's power to be with us and rebuild our lives after such a tragedy. It is my hope that as we sing these hymns, even in the tragedy and in the challenges and in the places where you find yourself today, that these hymns of the church, these Christmas hymns of the church, help you to renew your faith. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And before we go to the benediction, I was going to actually have a time of prayer. This is a time that you can open up your microphones. And if there is something that you would like us to include in our community prayer, that we ask that you share it with the community right now.
And if there's something that you would like us to hold on our hearts to pray for, you can put that in the chat and we won't announce that publicly, but we will make sure that that is held up in our hearts for prayer. I would like to ask for prayers for a couple of things. One, of course, I think I had mentioned last week that my son is preparing to deploy to Poland for about a year. And so Tuesday we have our last meal, if you shall say, together as a family to wish him farewell. So we bless, ask for blessings for him and his wife during that time of separation. And also would like to ask for prayers for plans that my daughter and I are trying to put together to be able to live together while she is in graduate school so that that is less of a burden on her. And it's becoming a difficult plan to implement, and we're hoping that God will grant us that opportunity.
I'm going to ask that we be in prayer for our church as a whole, as there are many things taking place as we move toward our final service. I'm especially in prayer for those who are trustees, who we got our schedule this week of meetings almost daily for this closing. I ask that you pray for them.
I want to pray for your church, for the move that you are making now. You will never close completely because your spirit and your love will continue always. Know that God has not forgotten you and that God is moving each and every day to make this a smooth transfer, but to move to a new phase in your lives. I have been blessed to close 3 churches. I know the pain that goes with that. So pray with me for the peace that passes all understanding, because we never truly understand why. But we know God is leading us. All great things come for good who love the Lord and you love Jesus.
For a minute, Auntie, I thought you were just going to pray us out. And I would have welcomed that too. Any other prayer concerns among the men and women of the church?
Prayers for those facing health challenges these days. I know that COVID has made it easier, but I think there's a lot of people discovering there are things that they ignored during the isolation of COVID that are becoming a more urgent issue than what they had thought before, and to grant God's peace as they go through that struggle.
Yes, Neota.
I'd like us to pray for those who have lost loved ones due to gun violence. It troubles me deeply that this is becoming almost routine and we're almost becoming desensitized to it, and that cannot happen. These are lives lost.
Thank you. This has nothing directly to do with anybody at Arlington Forest, but this week I have done 3 counseling sessions with parents with young adult children at some of the mental issues, mental illness and mental health challenges that they're experiencing coming out of this pandemic. Ask that we just keep all parents, not just those with young adults, but all parents in prayer during this time. Let us pray. God, we come to you knowing that in the midst of all things that happen, that you are with us. It sometimes doesn't feel like it, God. It sometimes feels really heavy and it hurts to the point when we almost want to give up. But I'm asking God for this community and that you would renew our faith, renew our energy to follow you, even in the midst of those things that would be heavy on our hearts, be heavy in our lives, and would stop us from totally pursuing the purpose that you have for us. Lord, move in our lives so that we become the radiant beacon of light that the hope needs, that the world needs to see. That even in the midst of our calamity and tragedy, your light shines through us. Lord, be with us as we are moving as a church to another season, a season where we may not meet together, but we will still have your spirit in us and moving throughout the community because of us. We ask that you speak directly to these needs that have been brought up in our community, that God, you would bless Leslie's son as he's about to be deployed, that you would bless him and his family so that your hands of protection around him as he goes to serve this great nation. Lord, be with Leslie as the mother to live in faith that she's not anxious about her son going to serve. Lord, we're praying for those who were affected in the Tulsa race massacre, not only the United Methodist churches and the people of the Greenwood community, but for the whole city, that there'll be healing and reconciliation in this time. Lord, we are asking that you bless the trustees of Arlington Forest as we move toward that place of being that new season and being in your service. Lord, we're praying for the health challenges of men and women throughout our congregation and throughout our community. We're praying for young adults, and Lord, let us not be desensitized to this gun violence that is happening all too often, Lord, for all the lives lost. Lord, let us not become desensitized that these men and women, these children, are all sacred and blessed by you, and that our love for them should not be that they're another statistic, but that they are your children who have lost their lives needlessly. We're asking God that you would let your spirit be with us in each individual home, even as we worship here together, and pray the prayer that your son Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now we're just about ready to go to the benediction. there are a couple of things I'm going to say right before the benediction. Number one, thank you, Everett. Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Louise, for being so faithful and providing music every week. We really do appreciate it. And just thank you so much from the bottom of my heart. Thank you, Leslie, for getting worship prepared every week and getting everything together. Even in her absence, we're going to thank Linda for her contribution. But thank you to everyone who has supported us. This week, we may not have a newsletter. My giftedness in doing newsletters is like zero, but we're going to see what we can do But if you don't get one, do not be panicked. You will get the information necessary. Please attend the church meeting on the 2nd, June 2nd. And finally, our final three worship services will all be in person. At this moment, the plan is that all three worship services will be in the sanctuary. On the first Sunday, we will be with First Vietnamese. They have reserved the first six rows for us, and then their church will sit behind. And Louise will be leading the music that Sunday, along with whoever she chooses. Everett, you know, you're always welcome. Bill, but I won't volunteer you. I've given Louise permission to make those decisions. So I'll leave it with her. The second Sunday will be my last Sunday preaching on the 13th. But I will be there, and we're inviting past pastors who have served the church to either send a video or to be in person with us. I will be giving each of them time within the midst of the worship to share. Then on the 14th, as Leslie has already said, we'll be going out to dinner together. And then on the 20th, we'll have our final worship service together. I will be there with you. Our preacher for the day will be our district superintendent, Sarah Calvert. And I don't know everything that's going to be in that service yet, because it's a standard service that they have not gotten the order of service. But we'll be asking as many members of the church to participate as possible. Also on the first Sunday, First Vietnamese wants to honor each family of the church. So if you can just give, you know, a call to the church or send me an email. So they're going to provide something for every family of the church. We just want to get a rough count of how many people will be there. Now we're ready for the benediction. Lord, send us from this place knowing that it will be well with our souls, not because we're so great, but because you're great. Lord, be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you again, everyone, for joining us on this Sunday. And I also want to say to Everett, Bill, and Louise, I think this was some of the best music you guys have done. The harmonies were just beautiful. So thank you so much for sharing your talents and making all of those hymns even more beautiful, especially today.
If I can say a word or two, since my name has been mentioned several times, how much I really have enjoyed doing the hymns over the past year with Louise, with Bill, with Emily, with Pastor William. Judy appeared a couple times, different ones, and it really has been good to stay in practice, to do hymns that we all enjoyed doing, and to then be able to share them with everybody on Sunday mornings. So thank you for letting me work with you and with Louise to do the hymns and to work through this. Thanks.
Thank you, Everett.